Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to what is officially the second day of the 2017 legislative session, the second day of the 30th Alaska Legislature. It's a real pleasure to appear before you. I would like to welcome you all to the speaker's chambers. I'd also like to make a personal welcome to the students and those who are from the Bristol Bay region here visiting the legislature this week. Thank you for taking a week out of your time to participate. Let me start by introducing the members of the new Alaska House Majority Coalition. To my right is Majority Leader Chris Tuck. To my left is House Rules Chairman Representative Ledoux, Gabrielle Ledoux. And behind me, to my right, is Co-Chair of House Finance Committee Neil Foster, Majority Whip, Representative Louise Stute. She also chairs the House Fishery Committee. And then the Vice Chair of the House Finance Committee is Representative Les Guerra. And least but never last is Representative Paul Seaton, who is the co-chair of the House Finance Committee and will be working on the operating budget. So in beginning our conversation this afternoon, let me begin with the fact that we all realize that the challenges that face the legislature this year are pretty significant. In an ordinary year, the policy issues, the budget issues, everything that's confronted or that confronts the legislature is weighty in its own way. But at this juncture, we're looking at a fiscal future for Alaska that looks extremely cloudy. We're down to our last year's worth of savings. The legislature in the last several years has been pretty active in ratcheting back spending. We have made some tough choices heretofore. State agency spending, for example, is at calendar year 2006 levels. Our capital budget has dwindled down to virtually just a shoestring budget, enough to accommodate the federal monies that are coming into the system. And we're looking at a situation where with 1 year's worth of savings, the economic future of the state, the jobs that many of our residents rely on, the school system, public safety, other things are at stake if we don't take some decisive action. So we come before you today as the new majority in the House to basically say that we're willing to take those tough steps, to make decisive action, to do what it takes to put Alaska's best foot forward, not just for this session, but for many years to come. And so with that, I'd like to turn things over to the Majority Leader, Representative Tuck.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Yeah, this is the good news. We have Alaska independents, Alaska Democrats, Alaska Republicans coming together, putting aside partisan politics to focus on saving the economy. Alaskans are beginning to feel the effects of these budget cuts. And we all know that you can't cut your way into prosperity. We are going to have to be innovative in some of the things that we're going to be doing this next session. We want to protect the health of the economy. We want to protect jobs. We want to protect public safety. And we want to make sure that our children have a future. So we're going to be protecting public education and continuing investments in those areas. And as we go through the new leadership that we have in the House, we're going to look at new ways of doing things. And we are going to listen to minority bills. We're going to move some minority bills. So any good idea that's out there, we're going to consider. It's not going to be us versus them. It's going to be all of us working together, because we're all in this situation, and it really is going to take us working together to make that happen. We are not afraid of a fight. Not that we're going to avoid a fight, but we do not want to be fighting just for the purposes of fighting. We actually want to get things done this session. We're going to take action. We're going to take charge.
So with that, questions?
Please identify yourself.
Yes, and please do identify yourself.
Good morning still, I think. Nat Hurst with Alaska Dispatch News. Representative Edgerman, you mentioned that sort of the tough steps that are going to be needed to fix the state's budget problem. When are we going to find out from the House majority what exactly those steps are going to be? And sort of related to that, are you guys going to build a budget that is sort of that fills the deficit, or are you going to build the spending plan first and then come up with revenue measures later?
So I want to eventually turn the mic over to Co-Chair House Finance Representative Seaton to give you maybe a little bit more details. But let me just start out by saying that As we sit here in the second day of the session, I don't think it's lost on anyone that all the players in the legislature, the various caucuses, those that work throughout the system, those on the third floor of the governor's office, I think we all can agree that we've got a problem that we need to confront. I think that's the starting point. Now, in terms of the details, the various moving parts on the budget reduction side, or the generating of new revenues, or anything else that may be coming down the pike, that's all part of the deliberative process. I mean, we all know that. It's, you know, if you look back in a time, it was 1977 when the first drop of oil flowed through the pipeline. And so we've had the luxury, and I don't think I'm overstating it, of here in Alaska being able to rely on one source of revenue. And we don't have that luxury anymore. And I think everybody can agree on that at this point. And to make those tough choices really is going to take a lot of hard work in the committees. And it's going to take a lot of input from the public. It's going to take a lot of the governor being involved. And so that's setting the stage for turning next to Representative Seaton, if you would want to please provide some more details.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. There were really two questions there. One was budget and one was fiscal plan, and we need to separate those. So addressing first the fiscal plan, this caucus is proposing that we go forward with a comprehensive fiscal plan, and those are going to be developed in two steps because you can't tie everything together. So the House Finance Committee will be coming out with shortly a fiscal plan that will deal with the restructuring of a permanent fund, some kinds of issues with a PFD, also with a tax categories. I think we've seen that some of that last year. It'll be different somewhat than House Bill 365 last year. And then the Resources Committee will be generating some issues on the tax credits. That is a big issue because that's a huge spending issue for us, and we know we need some sustainable, some cuts there. So it'll be coming from committees.
So will we know sort of what the measures are to fill the deficit when you guys pass a budget, like a spending plan, or do you think that will come later in the session, kind of like last year?
Well, our looking at the budget subcommittees are just spinning up right now, and what we're doing is we've totally revised that system. What we've done is instead of ad hoc taking seven members from across the legislature and putting them in a room and cross-scheduling with other committees and having them consider the budget, what we're doing is having the policy committees actually function for half of their time as the budget subcommittee. So you have the people that wanted to be on these committees that are utilizing their expertise in those areas. They will also be considering the budget subcommittee work. And so in the past, we've had a really problem because ideas have come forward of how to consolidate or how to eliminate something, and then they fall away because you have a group of people that have not been coordinated. Here we'll have the subcommittee, will be the policy committee, so any statutory changes that are needed will be immediately available for them to be all informed and gear up and make those changes.
And I think what I'm sure it's been underscored here at least a couple times so far is we're taking this issue seriously. You know, we're jumping out of the gate with focusing not only on just putting the budget together, but also the longer-term view of a fiscal plan. And that's something that the legislature, at least in the House, that we've normally not done in the past.
And if I may add, I really appreciate what Paul has done in suggesting that we bring the policy and the budget committees together in such a way, because it is going to take some innovation to make this work.
And if I can just interject something here, I'm really pleased with this because this is really thinking outside of the box here. Those subcommittees haven't worked for years, and it's great to see that somebody has taken charge of it and not only complaining that they're not working, he's actually doing something to make them work.
Hi, Liz Raines with KTVA. The governor and the Senate majority have come out with their roadmaps, so to speak, of the amount of cuts that we should see this year and into the future and where those cuts should fall. They've mentioned specific departments. I'm curious to hear your thoughts on those two proposals and whether or not we'll see a similar sort of roadmap with a specific number of cuts and where you'll start with that.
Well, I would say a starting point for our caucus is that we do not believe we can cut our way to a sustainable fiscal future in Alaska. That's the starting point. Now, in terms of an overall comprehensive fiscal plan, it's a multi-tiered from our perspective. It's targeted reductions that are judiciously applied to the core services that Alaskans have relied upon for years. It's also looking at new revenue measures. It's also looking at oil tax credit / subsidy reform, and really essentially anything else that might be on the table, as the majority leader alluded to a moment ago, we're open to new ideas, to things that may be outside the box that contribute to putting a plan together that not only provides a sustainable pathway forward, but something that our public has an opportunity to be a part of.
Do you agree with the cuts that the governor is proposing?
Well, you know, the governor's budget, and I've been around this process for a few years. I've seen many governor budgets come and go, as they say. That's a starting point. So whether I agree with them or not, what emerges down the road, I think, is a more important point.
And I would like to add that from what the Senate has proposed and what they did last year, we don't want to see another $100 million or just an arbitrary number of unallocated cuts. That's really lazy budgeting. And one of the things we appreciate about the governor's is it's thoughtful. It's detailed. You know, we know why he's doing some of the things we do. We're going to be bringing in the departments. We're going to be doing our overviews, and we're going to see if there's ways that we can do it better.
Austin Barron from KTUU. I wonder, even if specifics are not there, are there any of the big fiscal proposals that are a non-starter or very unlikely to find a warm reception among this caucus, whether it's spending reductions perhaps to the university system or the K-12 funding formula or anything else?
Well, I can tell you, having sat on the Finance Committee for the last 6 years, that the most painful component of being a legislator is cutting the budget. And I think that's a difficulty that crosses all political persuasions. So from that standpoint, cutting the budget, is something that, like I said a moment ago, we're going to look at it. It has to be part of the process. Downsizing state government while not downsizing essential services. The earnings from the permanent fund, when you're looking at a fiscal gap that's not in the hundreds of the millions, but it's in the billions, and you're looking at 1 year's worth of savings, or the signs that the statewide economy here in Alaska is already beginning to teeter, and that the recession word is being more commonly used by state labor economists and others. I think that all just sort of points towards taking decisive action this session, which is what we're here to talk about today.
When you say essential services, could you just define that? What is essential services that cannot be cut?
Representative Garrett, did you want to step forward? You haven't had an opportunity to speak yet.
Thank you. First, I just want to say that I'm honored to serve with the new caucus, with members who are independent, Republicans, Democrats, and this leadership team. There's nothing that's a sacred cow in the budget, but we have to recognize that people need to be educated if we want a trained job force, that neighborhoods need to be protected if we want people to feel secure in their homes. There have been significant cuts to both education, whether at the university level or K-12, and to our public safety system. At the same time, we have a $3 billion budget deficit. And there's no magic wand that's going to fit into a 13-second soundbite. I think what we're all saying is we're going to look at everything. Were you to cut $3 billion out of the budget, the university says through their study that we would lose 45,000 jobs. That's not an option. You don't want to put 45,000 people out on the street and destroy the economy. Were you to cut $1 billion, you'd lose 15,000 jobs. you would destroy the economy. So we have to be careful. We have to look for smart cuts, but we also have to look to protect the things that our speaker said, the things that people rely on in their day-to-day lives. Public safety and education are very important to us. We're at day two. We're not going to come out with sort of false numbers and say this is the number that the budget's going to be. We're going to look at everything and look for smart cuts, but not reckless cuts.
Becky Bohr with the Associated Press. One thing that the Senate has been speaking about is a spending limit of some sort, codified in law, or potentially revisiting the limit in the Constitution. Can you speak to that idea? Is that something that the caucus itself is amenable to, or is that something that's concerning?
Well, while Representative Seaton is coming to the table, the concept of a spending limit or a spending cap certainly is not new to the legislature. That's been around for a long time, and as we know, there's a spending cap that's already in existence. I think it's a constitutional provision. But, you know, as circular as this conversation might seem, clearly, like Representative Garrett was just talking a moment ago, we're going to have to make reductions. And hopefully we're going to make those reductions in a very, very careful way so that we don't harm the essential services. Day two of the session, the Senate has their approach. We're developing our approach in the House. Somewhere down the road, these approaches are going to merge, and probably whatever comes about from that point is going to be a product of a lot of cooperation, a lot of collaboration, and you know, you just can't emphasize enough not only the magnitude of the fiscal gap as it appears today, but also the tough decisions that are going to take us to the point where we all can agree with different philosophies and how much should be reduced, the source of the new revenues, the earnings of the permanent fund, and certainly protecting a permanent fund dividend going forward. That's a critical component of our plan as well.
In the House, what we want to do is make sure that we have a robust plan that comes forward that will auto-correct and self-correct over different circumstances. However, a spending cut or a spending cap is something different. That is has one use only, and that is to constrain and limit future legislatures from addressing the problems that may occur in the future. And so, you know, I think that our caucus is looking for a reasonable and responsible plan that will work in many circumstances, but saying that we can direct and limit future legislatures is quite a different matter than what we're proposing.
Shauna Crondall, Alaska Education Update. It sounds like you're going to be looking at everything. In terms of education, what are you going to be looking at in education? Are you going to look at the foundation formula or different? What are you going to look at for education?
Well, before we turn to one of the co-chairs, or perhaps the majority leader may want to address that as well, you know, when you look at the entirety of the budget itself, about a half of the budget is sort of sprinkled in between education and the health and services components, and then the rest of the, as we call it, the UGF, designated general fund money, is shared amongst the 14 or so state agencies and whatever sliver of a capital budget we have and all of the statewide items that are out there. And really, that sort of defines where we're coming from. We don't think we can cut our way to a sustainable budget. But in terms of K through 12 expenditures, you know, I'm not here to say that there's gonna be major reductions, because it's a priority of our caucus to support education, to support teachers, to support the quality of educational services we offer today. But at the same time, I don't think anybody's saying anything's off the table at this point. So, Chris, did you wanna say more?
Well, I just wanna say that I'm proud that our Constitution really puts an emphasis on education. You know, when we did have a tax, it was an education tax, and I was proud that Alaskans saw that investment as being necessary. That's one area that we may want to clean up. We want to make sure it's efficient, but as far as delivering education to the classroom, we want to protect that. Throughout history, when you look at those societies that invested in education, they were the most advanced cultures that we've had. And Alaska right now, we're at a crossroads. We want to protect the economy, but not just protect it. We want to use innovation to really make our economy vibrant. And the best way to do that is investing in education from pre-K all the way up to the university level.
You know, it's interesting just to add one more thing, because you do raise a good point, Shauna, that the Moore case, I think it was 2004, a class action lawsuit that was filed that I think took 8 years to resolve. The state spent $20 million or so in litigation costs and so forth. And the end result of all that was that the state put more money into public education, not less. So we do have constraints by way of our Constitution requiring us to provide equal public education to all the students throughout Alaska. So that makes it more difficult to make significant cuts to the public education system in light of, again, a huge fiscal deficit.
Thank you. Matt Buxton, News Miner. You know, the caucus is organized around the budget, and obviously the budget's like the big pressing issue this year. But are there any sort of non-budgetary legislative priorities for the caucus? And, you know, might this process of having committees that are doing policy and subcommittee budget work, does that at all strangle that process? Or how did the, you know, running non-budgetary bills while they're also helping put together the budget work?
Well, I actually think it works pretty well, but we actually haven't tried it yet, so we'll just have to see how it works. But when we had budget subcommittees, I mean, people were involved in those budget subcommittees, so now they're just going to be sitting on a subcommittee, which is the standing committee which they're interested in. So I don't see it impeding things as far as consideration of non-budgetary bills at all. And you were asking whether there are any caucus priorities with respect to some of the non-budgetary things. There was a bill last year that managed to get caught up in end-of-session problems, and that was to be providing medical insurance for the survivors of policemen and firefighters who were killed in the line of duty. And we are hoping to see that bill on the floor soon and over to the Senate.
Thank you. And if I could just add, the importance of the subcommittee process and the new process is such that there are going to be times when we want to make changes to, you know, the fee schedules and things like that. That can only be done in some circumstances by statute. And so it's going to be important that the finance subcommittee is also meeting with the standing committee. And that way they can be on board when it comes to needing to introduce the legislation for that.
I can just interject something here. There were so many times in subcommittees that I can recall over the last four years or so where someone would bring up a really good idea in subcommittee about something which needed to be changed in statute, but the subcommittee wasn't a committee which could deal with statutory changes. So that's really going to streamline things here.
And then I would also like to add that I'm proud to have House Bill 1, which is the elections reform. Not necessarily elections reform, but just cleaning up the elections process a little bit. Allowing people to have same-day voter registration. They can vote the same day that they register. It just allows them to do a question ballot, just like we do with people who are voting outside their district. Redefining early voting, because we really have three locations for early voting. That's Anchorage, Fairbanks, and Juneau, because of division of elections locations. Outside of that, it's in-person absentee voting, and people get confused by that. Are you in person or are you absent? You know, so redefining that so it's less confusing. And then also, once someone votes absentee, which is a way of voting by mail, they can continue voting by mail throughout all the elections until they missed one. And then they would have to re-register to vote by mail. And then making sure that our polling places, once established after redistricting, that those polling places do not move, because voters are finicky, we're all finicky, the masses are finicky. If you keep moving around the polling locations, voter turnout's gonna be lowered. So just some of the things. And as we move forward also, we're going to be looking at some criminal justice changes. We had a major bill that went through last year. Some things may have gone a little bit too far, but this year we're going to be looking at ways that we can enhance public safety.
So we got just a handful of minutes left, and we have to excuse our finance co-chairs here momentarily. So if they get up and leave right before 1:30, that's why. Representative Ledoux, you wanted to make a point?
I just wanted to make a point on the same day voting with that. That is not really particularly a radical idea, and that's the way that the presidential elections are done. You can register and vote the same day for the presidential elections, and it's counted for the presidency. It's simply not counted under state law, and this bill would change that.
Steve Quinn with Bloomberg. I've got two questions speaking to your caucus. The first is, last year, I believe it was Representative Tuck, you were pushing for a Ways and Means Committee, and I don't see that this year. I'd like you to speak to that, please. And also, you talk about the caucus. Are you bound by a budget vote the way previous majorities are or have been?
We are still a non-binding caucus. As a matter of fact, I want to announce that we are going to be having our open meeting caucuses starting next week, a half hour prior to going on the floor. So we're going to return back to that tradition that we had. And also, what was the first part of your question? Oh, from last year, Ways and Means Committee. Yeah, so, and that's one of the things that the minority had offered last year, to share the burden, to share the responsibility of making some of the difficult decisions that we're going to have this year. This year, we looked at the makeups that we have right now, and with independents, Democrats, and Republicans coming together, we didn't feel like the need for that at this point, especially with the budget subcommittee restructuring. So we're going to see how this works first, and if this makes us efficient and effective, then no need to be creating more committees and slowing things down. And in this case, we're trying to be as efficient as possible through the process and get our job done in 90 days.
Andrew Kitchenman, Alaska Public Radio Network. The governor included an $890 million amount in his budget that he did not provide revenue for. He said he wanted to work with the legislature to fill that gap. Traditionally, governors have proposed revenue to pay for the budget. So what do you think of the governor doing this, and what are your thoughts on filling that gap?
Well, I guess I would start by saying that the governor clearly is taking a different approach overall to working with the legislature. Last session, if I can even remember that far back, it seems years ago by now, but the special sessions that extended through May, June, and July saw a lot of things on the table at one time. And as time demonstrated, you saw major policy items begin to compete with each other. The governor is taking a different approach, albeit offering a budget that's not fully funded in terms of identifiable revenue sources, but I'm encouraged by the fact that the governor is sort of narrowing down his scope, and yes, there is a budget hole in what he's presented, but again, the heavy lifting that's going to take place, I think, is going to involve the governor, the Senate, the House, the minority caucuses, and so forth. So am I surprised by the governor's budget proposal? No. We've seen governor budget proposals from the past that have had things that have not been politically palatable to the legislature, but that's just one more challenge that's in front of us.
I think we can do one last question. James?
Speaker Edgemond, you mentioned earlier a desire to protect a permanent fund dividend going forward. There's a bill that's been introduced in the House and also in the Senate to restore the remainder of the dividend that was cut by the governor's veto. Is that something you anticipate the House taking up, or is that a fight that's already been lost?
Well, I'd also point out that there's litigation that's unresolved as well. And I don't know the timeline of that. I've heard tell that may be coming forward as late as next year, too. So I don't think it's lost on anybody in this building, the importance of retaining a permanent fund dividend. What role that plays in the overall plan that emerges at the end of the session, what legislation is involved, really all that it's a blank slate right now. And so everything, is on the table.
One nice thing about permanent fund bills is we will hear from the public.
So, Mike, I think that concludes the presser for today. Thank you all for being here. We plan to meet on a regular basis starting next week.
Tuesdays at 9
in the morning. So thank you all for being here today.